Greetings to you all. My name is Tracy Doyle, and I'm the new director of the School of Music at the University of Puget Sound. I'd like to welcome you to the second installment of Lager's Perform series, featuring faculty and student performances that were recorded here on campus. As scientists around the globe look for ways for us to be together again, musicians everywhere are transforming the ways in which we connect with our audiences. We hope these performances will bring you joy and inspiration. We cannot wait to see you again. But in the meantime, we wish you peace and good health. Enjoy the performance.
Gaudete, 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 nights longer. Those of us in the Pacific Northwest do not even get the benefit often of star and moon and lights of the night. Our first reading comes from the poet Anne Porter, and her poem, Getting Up Early, brings us into a time of day that I personally try to avoid, but reminds us of the beauty and the mystery of those early pre-dawn hours and their lights. Just as the night was fading into the dusk of morning, and the air was cool as water, and the town was quiet, and I could hear the sea, I caught sight of the moon, no higher than rooftops, our neighbor, the moon. An hour before the sunrise, she glowed with her own sunrise, gold in the gray of morning. World without town or forest, without wars or sorrows, she paused between two trees. And it was as if in secret, not wanting to be seen, she chose to visit us so early in the morning. Getting up early. The image of the morning star is clearly captured in the Adelphian's next song, Here Shall a Star from Jacob Come Forth. Composed by Felix Mendelssohn in the early 19th century, this piece incorporates the famous German chorale, How Brightly Shines the Morning Star, at its end.
Oh.
please consider yourself invited to join the Adelphians as they sing the traditional gathering carol, Come On, You Faithful. It's pretty beautiful.
Thank you.
Our second reading tonight is a story from Scottish mystic and theologian John Philip Newell. The story wrote about a visit that he and his spouse, Reverend Allie Newell, took to spend some time in the ashram of Sri Aurobindo in Pondicherry, India. Aurobindo died in 1950, but over the course of his life, he transformed from a rebel and freedom fighter against the British Raj to a pacifist who called us, called all those who followed him, to change the world by recognizing the light in all things. Following his death, members of his ashram built a small town named Oroville, just outside of Pondicherry. Oroville was endorsed by the United Nations to belong not to one religion or group or nation, but to the people of the whole world. There are now over 50 nations represented amongst the couple thousand residents that live there today. The citizens of Oroville, in turn, built the Matrimonium, the temple of the mother. The temple celebrates the womb of life from which we and all things have come. It is an enormous golden sphere, 1,220 feet across. The inner chamber of the temple is completely white. Marble walls, massive pillars, carpeting, everything. It is a place of silence. No words, no ritual, no religious form or sound. There's an aperture at the top of the sphere through which light, sunlight, streams down, a single beam of sunlight. Above the aperture are prisms that track the movement of the sun across the day to reflect that beam directly into the chamber. And at the heart of the temple is a great crystal glass globe, 30 inches in diameter, into which that beam of light enters and refracts to fill the whole temple. This is the most important thing about the Matrimonium: the light at its center. It is the light at the heart of all life.
Thank you. Thank you.
the sublime spirituality of our personal pieces. Our next reading and the next song move us into the realm of the absurdity of this season. As we consider all the ways in which many of the traditions have been impacted by modern technology, the good people at McSweeney's Internet Tendency did some research for us and have uncovered the fine print of Santa's online privacy policy. It reads, Santa's privacy policy. At Santa's workshop, your privacy is important to us. What follows is an explanation of how we collect and safeguard your personal information. Why do we need this information? Santa Claus requires your information in order to compile his annual list of who is naughty and who is nice, and which your accuracy when he checks it twice. What information do we collect? We obtain information from the unsolicited letters sent to Santa Claus by children all over the world. Letters listing specific items they would like to receive for Christmas. Often these letters contain important additional information, such as which of their siblings are movie fans. Letters also provide another important source of information, fingerprints. We run these through databases maintained by the FBI, CIA, NSA, Interpol, MI6, Amazon. If we find a match, they go straight on the naughty list. What do we do with the information that we collect? Well, sharing is one of the joys of Christmas. For this week's reason, we enthusiastically share your personal information with unaffiliated third parties for marketing purposes. Easter Bunny, the Tooth Fairy, and this one of the year, especially Hanukkah and Harry. Voci's final song takes us further that direction, as you can tell. It's by the acapella group Straight No Chaser. Besides really poking fun at the commercialization of Christmas, the song reminds us to respect and include others of different traditions and ways of living, all while giving us a healthy dose of John Offenbach's most famous tune amidst some good-natured mayhem.
Oh,
Friends and families gather to eat, drink, and read poetry, often staying up all through the long night, feasting on nuts, fruits, pomegranates, and watermelons, especially. You break their fruits, remind them in the darks of winter of health and new life. Amongst the poets read that night, the writing of the Sufi mystic Hafiz are particularly beloved and a core part of the holiday and the culture. Here's one of Hafiz's best, a crystal ring. The earth lifts its glass to the sun and light is poured. The bird comes and sits on a crystal rim, and from my forest cave I hear singing. So I run to the edge of existence and join my soul in love and lift my heart to God, and grace is poured. An emerald bird arises from within inside me and now sits upon the beloved's glass. I have left that dark cave forever. My being is blended with his. I lay my wing as a bridge to you so that you can join us singing. Crystal Ring. Bob Chilkut's wistful arrangement of the Hanukkah song, Nisahilik, speaks to the wonder and mystery of the Hanukkah miracle. In contrast, presented to Powell's powerful rhythms of The Word Was God move the listener forward inexorably to its inclusive final chord that seemingly contains all the notes and all the words. Thank you for joining us tonight for our celebration of music and readings. Peoples have long gathered in this darkest time of year to find hope in community and in music. The Adelphian's final song, All of Us, speaks to these themes, drawn from the final moments of Craig Heller Johnson's powerful oratorio, Considering Matthew Shepard. This work was written in response to a terrible hate crime, the 1998 murder of Matthew Shepard. Shepard, a young gay man studying at the University of Wyoming, gave rise to a wave of emotion and art and resistance across this country and around the world. The powerful response of artists, including Johnson, were formative for me at the time and still shape my own commitments and work for liberation and justice today. We hope that all of us, with its message of joy and love in the face of violence and darkness, remind us to hold each other closely and celebrate the gift that we each are as we wait and yearn for the dawn of new light, of new hope. We find a glimmer of that light in this song and throughout this holiday season.